I'll just give you the little, I'm going to introduce both of our speakers, but I'm also going to give you a little, a series of questions which we put together as part of the description of what the talk will perhaps address. I don't know if we're necessarily going to cover everything, I don't know if we're necessarily going to answer all of these questions, but we'll see how we get on. And of course, it's your opportunity to ask questions as well. So the questions that I'm proposing that we perhaps think about are the following. What does it mean to make public art? I'm using that in inverted commas. How does working with art in the public sphere affect both the art and the public? Obviously, we're thinking here about definitions of what we mean by public, as well as what we mean by public art. And what the discussion is a discussion with an artist, curator, well, I'm going to be introducing both of you, public programmer, about these questions, about what public means. And it's also kind of interesting for us, which is interesting for me, within Sluice, to think about whether or not Sluice itself is a kind of public artwork, or what it means for us to be working with the public, because that has been, as I mentioned, our kind of core from the very beginning. It's been making contemporary art, and especially contemporary art practice, a public, a matter of public discussion and analysis. So I'm going to introduce both of our speakers now. We have images which we'll describe, and I hope that you are more or less able to see them. Sorry, it's a bit wonky, but it's quite cool, sort of cool in a 90s way, I suppose. So first of all, Simon Periton. Am I pronouncing it? I should have checked this out first. Periton.
Yeah, Simon. No, Simon. Yes, that's right.
Simon Periton.
Yeah, right.
Simon Periton is an artist working across a range of media. He was born in England in 1964 and studied at Central St. Martin's School of Art. He's worked on a number of significant public artworks in recent years, as well as continuing to exhibit both in the UK and internationally. We're going to be seeing some of Simon's work and discussing his role as an artist who works within this public sphere. Jennifer Thatcher, our other speaker, is a freelance art critic, lecturer, and public programmes curator. She was curator of the public programme for the 2014 Folkestone Triennial and director of talks at the ICA London from 2003 to 2009. She is writing a book on public art commissioned by Future City and the Crown Estate for the redevelopment of St. James's Market. So it gives you a sense of what we're going to be talking about. We have a practitioner, and we have a curator and a public programmer. So we're going to be hearing both aspects of this idea of working with public art. We're going to start with Jen, and then we're going to move on to Simon. And I'm going to hop over there and move the slide. So when you want to move a slide, just say slide, say, click your fingers, whistle.
Okay, thank you for coming, everyone. I recently did some thinking about public art and the definition of public art for the Whitstable Biennial. They asked me to write a couple of articles for their Whitstable Biennial journal to get everyone fired up about the next year's Whitstable Biennial. So I thought I'd adapt what I said for that and talk through that at the beginning. So my first slide is a Banksy. In Folkestone, called Art Buff. And on the last day of the 2014 Folkestone Triennial, a scuffle broke out between protesters and builders who had been hired to remove this Banksy from the wall of Payers Park, which was a project developed by Muff Architecture Art for the Folkestone Triennial. The protesters were trying to stop the builders removing this work, claiming that it was part of the triennial, belonged to the city, and quoting Banksy's website where he had said that the work was part of the Folkestone Triennial, kind of. Very ambiguous. But the wall, it turned out, belonged to a local family, the Godden family, who counterclaimed that they didn't have the resources to maintain the work and keep it safe. They had a security guard for a bit. And decided to sell it for charity, a family cancer charity. So a complicated scenario. They sent it to Miami to sell, didn't sell, and then just recently the Creative Foundation, which is the parent company of the Folkestone Triennial, decided to sue the Godden family and try and bring it back. Currently there's nothing there. So it prompted lots of questions. Who does the Banksy belong to? Should the public have been consulted about whether it should have been removed or not? as many locals had requested. Does art need to be commissioned to be public art? Was it an unofficial addition to the Folkestone Triennial? Who commissioned it? Did anyone? Is it public art or just street art? Is it legal, illegal? Loads of questions. So public art is an odd term. Should we differentiate between an art audience, one who define themselves as being specifically interested in art, and a non-art audience who might just come across a work of art by chance and might not recognise it as art? There's always that possibility. Should we expect everyone in the public to be interested in art? Is public art for the public, with the public, by the public, or just in public? So Situations are a public art research and commissioning agency run by Claire Doherty in Bristol, and they recently published a booklet called The New Rules of Public Art. And rule number 10 was, don't waste time on definitions. These are kind of futile and unhelpful. They said there are more important questions to ask. Does it move you? Does it shake you up? Does it shake up your perceptions of the world around you or your backyard? Do you want to tell someone about it? Does it make you curious to see more? So, in fact, the word or the term public art is rarely explicitly used by commissioning agents. Art Angel's website doesn't mention it, nor does the Mayor's Office for the Fourth Plinth programme, that's not called public art, it's just called a prize and an invitation to make astonishing new works for the centre of the capital city. Cameron Cartier and Shelley Willis, editors of the Practice of Public Art book, go further and argue that public art is a dirty word, marginalised as a practice by the fine art community, largely ignored or sensationalised by the press. And reasons for this, they suggest, are this lack of definition, the fact that public art is not specifically addressed in art schools, and a lack of a critical and evaluative framework for this. Next slide, please. So this is a work by Nina Power, which was shown in a group show at MOT International Gallery in 2014, and offers a very cynical view of the public and public art. So her first observation is, there is no more public space, only public order. And she goes on to characterise the public as unhappy, brutalised, and confrontationally as in the streets and as a slow-moving riot. The public for her is a bourgeois concept. Indeed, the reluctance to define public art suggests a wider discomfort with who art is for and what its function should or might be. And if we take that term, art in the public realm, rather than public art, that throws up a number of other questions about defining the public realm. After all, if we mean public as opposed to private spaces, this is problematic. Many public spaces are owned by private landlords or developers, such as More London in the South Bank near here, who commissioned Fiona Banner, for instance. And ownership of land can be frustratingly difficult to locate, as land is let and sub-sublet. And public art might be commissioned by the government through local councils or public art agencies, which might be financed by public and or private sources, or commercial developers keen to demonstrate social responsibility. Then there's the added confusion that many indoor spaces are in public and open to all, like libraries and leisure centres, while many outdoor spaces are actually private. For example, a shopping mall like Liverpool One. The public art think tank ICSEA conducted a survey into public art in the autumn of 2013. They found that the main driver for public art continued to be the private sector money aligned to public art, public sector policy, especially the planning system, and that £90 million of the £167 million current overall value of the public art sector, it's huge, was raised via the capital budgets and planning agreements generated by local authorities. The conclusion ICSEA came to was that the recent, albeit slight, increase in the value of the public art sector was due to the recovery of the housing and development sectors and inclusion of public art in national planning policies. The downside of this, they found, was that while the UK economy recovers from recession, the predominantly female artists and art professionals working in public art don't directly benefit. And ICSIA noted a fall in jobs and fees from 2012 to 2013. And artists today, you might say, are uncomfortably aware that their art might be benefiting housing developers perhaps more than the local community. Can I have the next slide? So public art used to mean public sculpture, originally statues and monuments, and here's the King George IV, Trafalgar Square, as the fourth plinth commission next to this one in Trafalgar Square makes apparent. Developments around site specificity since the 60s, from minimalism to relational aesthetics and socially engaged practice, plus the blurring of boundaries between disciplines such as art and architecture, and the expansion of the field of sculpture, as famously described by Rosalind Krauss, have contributed to an expansion in the possibilities of working in the public realm. In 1995, the term New Genre Public Art was coined in the book Mapping the Terrain, New Genre Public Art, to acknowledge the range of media and approaches associated with public art. And currently the most common forms of public art are socially engaged practice and art and architecture, according to ICSIA, with outdoor arts and events-based activities increasing in popularity. And this freedom to use whatever medium is most appropriate to the artist can make for a very exciting public art, but can also confuse the public or audiences about what to expect, especially when the art doesn't necessarily look very much like art. The public interest element of public art is just as slippery. It's too simplistic to say that public art should engage people. That overused term suggests an enforced reaction from an audience with the paternalistic expectation that they should learn from it. Do we really want to presuppose what an audience should think? And should artists always be expected to make things better? During the 1990s and 2000s, the new Labour government placed high value on the benefit of art on local communities and regeneration schemes, pouring money into art that could tick the right boxes. And according to research by Josie Appleton, published in an essay, Who Owns Public Art, between 1990 and 1999, there were over six times more sculptures than there were at the other high point of statue mania between 1900 and 1909. And this was during the peak of public art mania in the 90s, of course, Gormley's 1998 Angel of the North. And as Josie Appleton provocatively concludes, this policy created art that was about officialdom's image of the public, not real communities of living, working men and women. It's also impossible to presuppose an unchanging context for public art, as this is impossible to presuppose an unchanging context as second guess the public's response to it. Sometimes an unexpected change in external circumstances can have radical, unforeseen effects on the reception of a work. So this was from the last Folkestone Triennial, it's a bit pixelated, but it's Alex Hartley's project called Vigil. And you can see on the top floor of this 60s hotel, the Grand Bursting, he set up a number of tents or portal edges, climbing tents, and either he or a member of the climbing community sat up there and watched from there and wrote a blog. And he left it very open-ended what associations you might make with this installation. It might be mountain climbing, it might be Occupy protests, refugee tents. But unexpectedly, during the triennial, news broke that 150 asylum seekers had temporarily moved into this hotel, been relocated from London, and therefore poignantly, forced a poignant dialogue between these new metaphorical aspects of the work and the real kind of political situation unfolding on the floors below. In a highly commercialised art world, it's impossible to pursue an entirely pure agenda for public art, if ever there was such a time of innocence. And unless the work is expected to be permanently installed in its original site, always conceived as an ephemeral project, then it might well be sold or shown elsewhere in a potentially very different context. Since the boom and bust of the 2000s, art galleries can't pass up and opportunities to sell work. Next slide. So following its display on Trafalgar Square's fourth plinth again, Yinka Shonibari's Nelson's Ship in a Bottle from 2010 was sold by its gallery, Stephen Friedman, to the National Maritime Museum in Greenwich to be displayed outside its new Sammy Offer Wing. Now this was made possible by public donations of £264,300 raised by the Art Fund, who had kick-funded the campaign with a grant of £50,000. And according to the Royal Museum's Greenwich press release, Stephen Friedman Gallery had then contributed the remaining money, £49,100, while The Guardian reported they had also offered a 15% museum discount and subtracted the production costs. Nonetheless, the gallery will have still benefited substantially from the project, and one might be tempted to question the ethics of asking the public to pay twice for a public artwork, since taxpayers' money or lottery money via the Mayor's Office and Arts Council England funded the original fourth plinth project. So what we might mean by public art is perhaps more an aspiration than a definition, art that we might hope will be seen by wider audiences, that might challenge where art should be seen, that might question issues of land ownership and public access, that might be more experimental than art shown with commercial interests at the fore. And there's an expectation, of course, that it should be site-specific, that it's a new commission that responds sensitively to the site in which it's located, perhaps drawing attention to historical aspects or future or alternative uses. Although that term site is, of course, another contested term. And Miwon Kwan, in her excellent history of site specificity and one place after another, prefers the more neutral site-oriented works and cautions that site might not be, should not be defined as a precondition, but be generated by the work instead. The best public art doesn't necessarily seek to explicitly address every or even any local issue either. Who can tell what might endear visitors to a work? This is not the same thing as saying that art can't be political. The lack of separation between art and life in public art means there is no alternative. Art's apparent innocuousness can mean that it can cut through a lot of local bureaucracy, even break down barriers between generations and political divides. After all, it's just as fashionable for aging Tories to show admiration for public art as young hipsters. And you might remember the Camerons pictured planting a ceramic poppy for Paul Cummins' Blood, Sweat, Lands and Seas of Red at the Tower of London. And despite liberal anxiety, this can be a step towards changing attitudes towards communities. Attempts at characterising place or situation can only ever tell a partial story, and furthermore, context change continuously, sometimes radically. Interpretations of public art will be as numerous as the number of visitors and very likely change over time. But it's these contradictions, ambiguities, and tensions that cluster around public art that make it intriguing to a wide audience and make it frustrating, fun, and rewarding for artists and curators working within it. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Jo. So many issues to consider. We'll move on to Simon and see whether some of those ideas perhaps...
Yeah, there's a crossover that might be quite...
Yeah.
Okay.
So again, give us a shout on the next slide.
Okay. Well, yeah. So I haven't prepared something quite in the smart way that Jen did. So I'm just going to wing it a bit, but that's fine. That's the way I do things. It's interesting because I didn't know what you were going to say actually, and there are some issues about some of the things that I'm going to show you that cross over a lot. Before I kind of explain about this particular project, maybe I should talk a bit about what I think public art is. It might be easier to, from an artist's point of view, really. It is fraught with complicated kind of decisions and potentially massive disastrous holes of traps that you might fall into as an artist. Ultimately, very often you're not in charge of all of the parameters that are set for such a project, so it's not the same as work. I mean, you know, maybe I'm stating the obvious, but I'll do it anyway. You know, you're not in control of the parameters that set how the work might even begin to exist. So there's a compromise straight away. The other thing is that it's very easy to find yourself just trying to solve somebody else's problem, if you choose to accept even any sort of brief or commission. You may well find yourself just in a situation where you're kind of solving other people's problems with your art, and there's a kind of instant kind of dilution of what you do as an artist potentially there. But having said that, there are lots of positives about it. I mean, very often that you find yourself working in a scenario that you would never normally find yourself working in, and if you're excited and interested in that, that's an interesting opportunity. You're also usually in a situation where you can realise something on a much larger scale, both in terms of space and maybe even financially as well, that you wouldn't be able to do yourself. So there's lots of kind of pulls and pushes about the whole kind of idea of taking on a kind of commission like that. For me, the interesting thing is always to make it, for a project to be interesting enough to kind of want to agree to do it, really, it has to have enough going for it that would either fit in with what I might be doing in my own practice anyway at that particular moment in time, or be of interest enough to kind of make me feel that I could push what I do in a different direction. And I would always argue against just kind of plonking something that I've already made or had made from somewhere else in somebody else's public art kind of realm just for the sake of it. And there are plenty of people who ask you along the way if they could just have, for instance, the same thing that you've done somewhere else in their shopping centre or wherever it may be. And I think the argument really is to make sure that you do sort of, it has to have some kind of relevant context, So for me, it might not be just about the site, like you were saying, but it might be something about the history of the place, or it must have a relevance for me to make it important. Otherwise, it's not really like making a piece of art. You're just doing, you're just designing something to put in a space to tick some property developer's box to allow them to do their flats because they put public art in it as well, which is, the other disastrous kind of area. There is something about the history of artists and property development which happened in New York first that I was kind of aware of, but it's definitely happened here in the sort of late 80s and 90s, in that way that artists are seen as the kind of first wave of that kind of gentrification process, where massive empty warehouse spaces in, well, not far from here really, in the sort of late 80s when I was a student, suddenly found themselves, I mean, they've been derelict for decades, suddenly found themselves having kind of funky art shows in with students from Goldsmiths to Chelsea to St Martin's, whatever. And that kind of then creates a buzz about a space. I mean, this is just one really quite practical reading of this scenario, but then you have a kind of buzz about a particular space. The kind of the wealthy people who want to collect art will get involved, usually with the kind of slightly scuzzier, poor artists who don't have any money, come to the spaces, see these spaces, see the art, and then see the spaces and think, oh, this is good, I'll buy this as well and I'll develop it. And in a way, the artists are kind of completely complicit in their own kind of death scenario, where they basically end up with nowhere to live or no studios because everything gets developed and they're kind of part of that process. And you can't help but be aware of that all the way along, right the way through. I'll stop there now, I'll talk about this maybe for a bit, because this is a project quite recently that it's actually still on, and it's I was invited by someone at Wadston, which is a National Trust property, but I thought it was interesting to show it because in some ways there's a kind of sort of blurred edge about whether a National Trust property may be a kind of private property or it might be a public space. I mean, the history of the National Trust comes out of a kind of fight to save land. I mean, it's quite sort of rebellious in its kind of its kind of inception, but it has become this kind of quite quaint sort of elderly demographic, whatever, it's funny. But there's a kind of move in more recent years, if you read between the lines of, and this is some of this is to do with arts funding and how that kind of has collapsed in lots of ways, where something like the National Trust, for instance, wanted to kind of change that, change its kind of dominant demographic and try and glean some of the kind of younger, funkier, for want of a better phrase, kind of horrible phrase, sort of Tate Modern audience. The National Trust, for instance, has kind of, you know, most of its members are sort of 55 plus, and most of the, I mean, a really crude reading is that most of the people that they think go to the Tate Modern are younger, and they wanted a kind of way of doing this, but that is directly linked to how they get their funding and how they tick their, you know, feet through the door, footfall, bums on seats, whatever you want to call it. So there was a kind of interesting scenario where some of the art funding money was being taken away from the arts and being redirected towards the National Trust. And then the National Trust were then commissioning artists to do projects. So it's another scenario where you're kind of complicit in this kind of, it's a sort of, you know, you're kind of going across a ravine on a bridge as someone's taking the bridge away from you behind you or something as you go. But you could just choose to not do anything about it, or you could choose to kind of get involved with it and somehow, if you can in some way with your work, kind of maybe draw attention to some of this stuff, I don't know. I mean, that would be the kind of, the sort of optimum political scenario. What was interesting about this, and there's a bit of a history about why these kind of two sculptural pieces exist. Waddesdon is this kind of completely kitsch, sort of Rococo villa, 25 miles outside of London, built really as a kind of folly in the sort of mid-late 19th century by the Rothschilds. I think initially as a family house, but maybe as a sort of weekend family, a weekend sort of party house in that kind of Victorian way. No children actually ever were born that survived there from the Rothschild family, so no one actually ever lived there as a family home at all, and it was always just this kind of weekend fun palace, really. And the Ferdinand Rothschild, who kind of commissioned and basically made the whole thing out of a completely sculpted and built this folly out of nothing really, in a kind of Ludwig-y kind of way. When he died, quite soon after the house, I think, was completed, his sister moved in, and Alice, and she kind of championed this kind of three-dimensional bedding, this planting thing, which in a kind of bizarre way is probably more famous now in a kind of quite a kitsch sort of public art way, you know, kind of welcome to Bournemouth on your roundabout or something, with a crown with flowers and stuff like that. And they have some sort of not really examples of her stuff, but maybe things that are based on sketches of hers in the grounds of Waddesdon. And I thought it, and I was asked if I would kind of respond somehow to the collection or the place or something. And I thought it'd be interesting just to do a sort of my version of the three-dimensional bedding, if you like. So we have a sort of scalp blade and an anarchy board. Actually, if you change this, there's two or three sides just to give you different angles. But so these are they're sort of living public artworks, I suppose, really, or artworks that are sort of, are they or aren't they, in the public sphere, and they connect to the sort of underground irrigation system. And that was unusual for me because I'd never done anything like that, and I would never have got round to doing anything like that. But the thing that I wanted to talk about this, apart from the kind of property ownership element of Waddesdon, I suppose, is that for me, most often the kind of ideas about the kind of the success of a sort of public art project, for want of a better phrase, is actually all about the negotiation that happens at the beginning of the project. It's all about how you manage to kind of get to do what you want with a bunch of people who have asked you to do something, and it's their money that are paying for it. And it's about that negotiation. And in a way, the most interesting and creative part of the whole process happens right at the beginning, because it's all about how you negotiate that kind of interaction. It's about the ideas and how an artist maybe persuades, convinces, challenges ideas about what somebody might want to allow you to do something. And there's quite a lot of that stuff. Very often you're talking to people who don't necessarily even have any kind of art background or interest particularly in art. You know, sometimes it's just a property developer or something like that. But you need somebody in there to kind of help you do that, and that's somebody like Jen, or you know, a really good art curator, or a really good kind of you know, project kind of coordinator or something. When you have someone that's interesting and interested in art and how that might position itself, then you get some quite interesting projects that kind of develop. So, should we do some more? Go the other way. Anyway, it's the, I'm just showing you the money shots really, because it's quite funny, but it's, anyway. And then, okay. And now this is a project, I did Charlie actually, that's for Camden Council's new building. And actually, I should ask, maybe, is it worth asking people to have ask questions at any point? I mean, maybe, or would you rather we did it all at the
should
end?
Should we go through
we'll do it through? Okay, fair. This, I was asked to sort of respond to make a proposal, and this is the other thing, that you know, very often you're sort of one of maybe half dozen people, or you could be one of, I don't know, 30, 40, 200 people that are kind of asked to submit ideas for projects. And you're given a kind of brief, and you're given quite, sometimes quite tight parameters, sometimes it's a bit more of just a kind of register an interest, and you're not supposed to have any ideas developed yet, or they all kind of vary in different ways, the way these projects might kind of arrive. This one was for a building that wasn't yet built. It was for a new sort of state-of-the-art building, which was the headquarters of Camden Council. They sold off lots of their valuable properties within the borough and were kind of planning to build a new headquarters. It was a beautifully carbon neutral building, and it didn't actually cost any of the taxpayers any money, as far as I understand, which is all great. And as part of it, they were asking for ideas for two different parts of the building that were public artworks. And in the end, Mark Titchener did something on the outside of the building, which is there, and it's a permanent art piece. And my sort of an area that I was given, and this is also based on somebody having an understanding of what I do and what, say, Mark does as well in their practice, because that's how those sites were possibly decided upon. I was given a 26-meter glass wall that was, you know, nearly 3 meters high, and just asked if I could do something with it. One of the issues about that, in practical terms, which probably didn't work as well for me, was that ideally, in those situations, you get involved as the artist as early on in that design process as possible, because then your idea becomes kind of embedded in the way the fabric of the building and the way that's made. In an ideal way, that's how those projects would always happen. More often than not, they don't, and the artist is left right at the last moment. That might be because you've got a quite kind of closely guarding set of architects on their building, on their kind of baby, and sometimes you feel like you're kind of, you know, you're treading on their toes a bit, and they don't really like that. Other times it's just completely logistical, and they haven't secured all the funds yet for the building, and blah blah blah. I can't remember exactly why this one didn't happen, but it wasn't terrible, but it was just that, you know, in a way, if you're going to do something on glass, it's going to be permanent, you'd kind of want it to be maybe, you know, etched on the panels of glass or something, or painted onto it. But these panels of glass were already in production, and so anything that I was asked to do to it was going to have to be done afterwards as a sort of applied thing. And also then that then introduces a kind of limit to how much money there is and what you can do with that and what you can do for the budget and if you can find a way of doing something for it. Now, I quite like that kind of challenge about trying to work out a way of, if I have a kind of an idea, then I quite like to try and work out a way of realising that idea within those kind of constraints. Some people will just tell you to fuck off, basically, and don't have anything to do with it, which is absolutely fine. But it sort of becomes a kind of challenge for me that I quite like it, and I think people who kind of get involved in this kind of way, they like to do that, and I think that's a kind of common thread in that way, you know, in this kind of topic. So this was a cut vinyl piece, it's applied to the glass, we had to go through all these kind of various health and safety issues about, you know, sort of partially sighted, about how we, I mean, they introduced another whole kind of sphere of things I had no idea that existed, and I'd done things before, and it was a new set of regulations where If you go back to the other shot for me, Brentford, then it was a on this side from where this when the photograph's taken, it becomes the it's the local it's the gymnasium of the building that you've been doing, and then that goes and leads down into the pool area or something. And on the other side, through the glass, there is one of the levels, one of the entrance levels to the building. And that right at the far left there, in part of the design, is, which I'll explain about in a minute, are a pair of double doors that go into the gym. So, in a way, part of what I was being asked to do was, what's that called, when you have that, when you have to put a mark on a glass to stop someone banging into it, it's got a really strange word. It's got a strange word, but it basically means it's what you put when you sometimes you see asterisks or dots on a wall so that you don't walk into it. It's called a strange word. I can't remember it. It's quite a normal word, but it's not the word you think it's going to be. Anyway, in a way, then there's an issue here. You have a big glass wall. It's a public space. Partially sighted people, you know, using the space, and you don't want them crashing into glass. So there's a kind of an element of that design that needs to go on. That's a practical application, as well as it being an artwork. So you know, you're doing it. The design idea, in a sort of an aesthetic way, was to do with kind of collapsing this idea of the kind of quite sort of hard urban feel of this new building with the nature garden that's visible through the glass on the across the road on the other side, which is actually, and it's very near where I live, so it's a kind of a place where my kids go, and they go for school, they go pond dipping and sort of thing. So, and the history of the site all around King's Cross is really kind of watery and canals and fairly sort of nature-based, you know, historically. And I wanted to kind of bring some of that back into this new building and this site. So the designs were based on some of the water plants and things that are from the Canby Street garden across the road. So that was my kind of way of making it specific and relevant to that. And it's offset, one thing on one side of the glass and the same design on the other side, just slightly misregistered, so it kind of does a kind of moving thing as you walk past it. It has a kind of slightly sort of 50s 3D thing, which I've done in cut paperwork somewhere in the past. But one of the things I did, and the colours were chosen from the colour scheme of the building that was already decided by the architects and the designers. Which that was all fine, except what we realised was that there's a kind of light reflective value between that all different colours have. And in fact, this is a really interesting idea, because in the future, people will design their houses based on this. It's a kind of, there is a kind of colour, a number colour theory, and it's to do with, you know, numbers and how much, colours and how much light they reflect, whether that they are on a scale between 0 or 1 and 100. And for health and safety issues and purposes, you can't, for partially sighted users of the space, you have to have a difference of, I think it's 30, was it? So if you've got black and white, you're fine, because you've got a kind of 99 and 1. But actually, all the colours that were chosen by the designers for use around the building were all within about 10 of each other. So there's a kind of a whole kind of colour theory thing to do with how public art spaces might now work in the future. This is a relatively recent new building regulation, but it's those sort of things that kind of come in that I think are interesting. Okay, I was trying to speed up a bit. Sure. So this is like a detail, and then we got it.
Oh, sorry, you want to move it to
something? No, that's good, we can then. Yeah. Projects in Colchester for an art gallery called First Sight, and in a way, I wanted to show this because this is an example of a sort of artwork in the public realm where I was really kind of left alone to kind of just develop it as I wanted to do it. And it was a really great thing to be kind of, you know, left in that way. I mean, I had to submit an idea and I had to go for an interview, and I talked about what I wanted to do. It was, you know, first time I'd ever really done anything like that sort of scale. When I first went to see the site, it had a little bit of a kind of metal frame, but it was essentially just a big mud square. I mean, there wasn't really anything going on. And the only thing I had to go on was a kind of tree survey that had been made of the site. And So I became kind of slightly obsessed with this tree survey, and Colchester's unusual because I think normally in, you know, sort of heritage sites or geologically speaking, one might consider significant remains to be, certainly in Colchester, to maybe like be, I think it's like a metre or a metre and a half below the ground. And for that, we're talking Roman. We're not talking Victorian or anything like that. That's just straight up. We're talking significant cultural remains. On the site, the first site, I think it's 15 centimetres below the ground. So every time anything was dug or an attempt to dig a foundation or something, somebody from English Heritage or someone comes along and sifts through the stuff that's been dug, and if there's something significant there, then you're not allowed to dig. So the whole building is really interesting because it's basically a kind of raft that sits on a kind of bed of sand or shingle or something. But that also had implications for what I could do in terms of stuff in the public realm, because you can't dig. Like normally, if you put something out in a bit, even in a bit of lawn, you've got to dig down a bit to put some footings or something in. You don't even have that luxury. So I kind of came up with this idea of making kind of lanterns that sort of lit up in the trees. And I think I've got some details of it, Ben. I think that.
Yeah.
But this is a quite a good shot.
Yeah.
Actually, have you got one before that? And there's one before that, or was that? I just put. Oh, okay. There we go. So, part of this. Sorry if this is getting boring, but it's quite interesting for me to talk about. So, the tree survey was interesting because the only tree that seemed to be of any historical significance on this tree, apart from all the various collapsed ashes and elms and things like that, was a mulberry tree. And I had absolutely no idea anything about a mulberry tree, except at some part of my sort of distant past, I had this kind of memory of a mulberry tree being linked to silk production and silkworms. And so sort of set about a kind of research, history, finding mission. And in a bizarre way, I remember thinking to myself, wouldn't it be really funny if it turned out that there was silk production in Colchester in, you know, 1620 or something? Obviously thinking that that's not possible. But set off on this kind of research journey where I was kind of, you know, trying to work out why there might be a mulberry tree in Colchester. You know, lots of nursery rhymes about the mulberry bush and stuff, which kind of relate to prison yards and going around. There was always often a mulberry tree in a prison yard, and people would, because at some point in the past, some regal do-gooder had decided he thought it might be quite a good idea to get prisoners to kind of try and make silk. So there was a kind of, for round and round the mulberry bush is a euphemism for basically doing time and being in jail and stuff. So little stories like this. Anyway, lo and behold, through one sort of series of routes or another, I found out that there actually had been an attempt at silk production in Colchester in the sort of like late 18th and 19th centuries. So I made my project around this idea of a kind of mulberry and a cocoon, if you like, and about how there's a sort of, it's a sort of invented but sort of not really completely untrue history of the site that no one would really have known about at all. So the project became about that. And if you go to the lamppost, the idea being that in the day they look like these lanterns look like this, they have a kind of sculptural presence of their own, and then at night they have a kind of solar panel and they're charged up in the day and they glow at night. And as far as I know, they're still there. And then there's a lamppost shot, which must be the one after that one. And this is sort of a nod to that Max Ernst collage. I kept thinking of that Max Ernst collage where there's a lamppost with moths and butterflies all flying around it, and in the background is a kind of a row of arches with kind of skeletons and something that I could have shown you if I was going to make more thing with. And somehow that was perfectly. That sort of perfectly resonated with the sort of history of Colchester, with this kind of these layers of remains and stuff. So I decided to make a kind of negative lamppost. It's a sort of inverted lamppost that draws moths, obviously, and butterflies, and, well, moths essentially, are drawn to these lights. There's kind of something perverse about making a kind of version of somebody else's collage, if you like, as a piece of work. Let's get on, am I
buffing?
So this is, I think this is the last one, isn't it? Which should be quite good. So this is a project in Brentford on the canal. And this actually goes quite nicely back to this whole idea of who owns the land and things. I was invited by the landscape architects who I'd worked on the first site project with. They'd been asked to do something to do with some Boris Mayer's money, Outer London Fund, for regeneration of various little sort of what were towns and villages on the outside of London, which are now part of Great London. And this one was Brentford. And Brentford High Street is fairly kind of dilapidated, has seen better days for sure. It's actually a really beautiful part of London where the River Thames meets the canal. Would have been a very important strategic point because of that, probably until as recently as, say, like 1950s or 60s, but it's sort of seen better days. And up on the great west road behind this, up this towpath, is this thing they call the Golden Mile, where you've got GlaxoSmithKline, all these big kind of companies. And what they were trying to do was trying to draw some of that money, this is from Hounslow Council, they're trying to draw some of that influence and money down out of the Golden Mile and down into and to help to regenerate Brentford, because there was a big discrepancy in the kind of financial situation. And so I was asked if I would just go and have a look at something and do something on the towpath. Anyway, halfway up the towpath are these enormous, and actually go to the next slide, these enormous kind of metal, and they were clad in corrugated iron, sheds that were used to do work on the barges and the boats. And the structures are quite amazing. I mean, they're vast kind of architectural wonders, but they were like a kind of mugger's dream, to be honest. It was all completely horribly run, you know, kind of collapsed and stuff. And I was just asked if I could do something. And I said, well, in a way, these sheds are the kind of, they're the kind of pivotal point of along this towpath to get these people. And is there some way we could make, and I had no idea of, there were no discussions about budgets or anything. This was actually something that I suggested. Is there some way that we could make these sheds an attractive beacon and draw people in and do things like that? So further down the canal, there was another set of sheds that were clad in sort of stripped timber. So I suggested we could do something where, again, in a way, we kind of collapse this idea of the sort of harder industrial space with the sort of softer landscape nearby. So it became a negotiation, quite a complicated negotiation, involving the mayor's office, the local council, the arts commissioning people for Hounslow, the landscape architects, maybe getting involved trying to organise events. I mean, you know, lots of different things about Canals and River Trust. I mean, really complicated. But one of the things that happened was that a project which, in the end, they had an amount of money that they'd earmarked for this project, and could I do something for this? I went, spoke to some people that I knew that could do sort of art fabricators, really, because I didn't really know anybody else. It involved dealing with that really complicated council procurement process, where, you know, which is a minefield, I mean, for an artist. And they suggested that maybe I could try and do some sort of organise the project myself as an art project, because that would circumnavigate all this. Anyway, it's very interesting to see how the political thing works to make something like this happen. But I had a sort of sum of money that they then earmarked for this project, and I wasn't far off it, actually, in terms of what it was going to be for me to do and for me to make the work and have it installed. But what happened then, which was completely bizarre, which is kind of why I'm showing it, is that the kind of knock-on effects of the costs to the council for the various things to do with the Canals and Rivers Trust, to do with the scaffolding access, to do with the railway that runs right behind, made the cost of the project quadruple in money from the money that I had been told that I had for my bit. Now my bit didn't actually change at all, and it came in pretty much as that. But at every stage of this process, when I went to a meeting and they said, you know, they would just add on £60,000 here or £80,000 here for something, and I'd be just saying, well, you know, we can't do it. It just doesn't make sense. There's no point in doing this project. And what I saw was a situation where money from a more kind of central pot of money was being given to a smaller local council, and they didn't want to give it back. So they made a situation where they forced things through. It was the most peculiar scenario for a project that in the end is only going to be there for 4 years and then it will be taken down. It's the most ludicrous scenario. And I just could not stop it happening. I couldn't, you know, it's just the most bizarre thing. And in a way that became an issue because that's public money that's being spent on an art project where I'd suggested something, I have a budget, and then you think that you're in control of that, and you sort of volunteer your bit, if you like, and then somebody else takes it and runs with it. And then, you know, it was kind of realised almost exactly as I imagined it might be, but I had no way of stopping it when this kind of avalanching kind of thing happens later. So, I mean, that might be something interesting to talk about, I think. And that's probably a good point to stop, I think.
Perfect.
Sorry about that.
Well, that's great. Thank you both so much for what you've said. I mean, it's so fascinating. I'm sure you agree. It's so fascinating to have those two perspectives kind of be brought side together, side by side. I mean, I'm very interested in thinking, but initially, I mean, obviously kind of a principal issue that was brought up with what you were saying, Jen, but also kind of like played out in a really interesting way with what you were saying, Simon, is this idea about what we mean by public when we talk about public art. I mean, it seems to me like I think that was very interesting in hearing about you, Simon, was the idea that some of the projects are permanent and are still there. And some, and the project you've just been talking about, you said it was only up for, did you say it was only a few months?
It was, I think it's only there for 4 years. I mean, the reason being that, and this links to something that you were saying, is that there's a, because it's the riverbank, it's owned by Canals and Rivers Trust, for instance. There's a development arm of Canal and River Trust called ISIS, ironically, that want to and are trying to kind of develop, you know, sort of residential spaces and sell off to maximum cost and stuff. You know, there's an element of that which is just normal and stuff like that. But it became quite acute. I became quite acutely aware of the fact that I was basically tarting up their
going all the brochures.
Yeah, their attempt to sell off the space for luxury apartments at some point, and there was no way I couldn't be, because that's one of the things that, you know, basically it's a derelict kind of shed overhanging the canal that no one's going to go down, and the whole idea was to kind of make it more usable for the public, but in doing that you also make it more attractive to a developer to be able to sell it. So,
and has it been used in the way that you wish it to be?
Has for a while, and then what happened is somebody completely unilaterally, nothing to do with me, took a whole section of the roof away. So, I mean, we had, you know, it had lighting as part of it, so at night it kind of lit, you know, it was a kind of beacon, you know, on the canal. But now because of that, there's a whole issue with sort of light pollution and other things that I'm not in control of. So.
I mean, I'm very interested in thinking about this idea of public art as something that exists. You know, much of the art that we see when we go to a commercial gallery exists within a very limited window of time. But the thing about a work of public art is that it can theoretically have this kind of longevity about the way that it's used, seen, experienced by members of the public in a particular community. And so thinking about the idea about the kind of time frame of public art and the way that it exists within people's lives, and also thinking a little bit about publicness and what we mean by public. So, you show your work within galleries too, don't you?
Yeah.
I mean, you have a practice which is both gallery-based and also public.
Yeah.
I mean, can you speak a little bit about your understanding of the way those two kinds of public differ when you make the work?
Well, I mean, in a way, that's how I started it. What I said earlier is because, you know, if I'm making work in the studio, I mean, I'm just completely free to do whatever I want. And in that kind of great egotistical artistic way, then that's probably what most of us do in some respects. You know, in a scenario where you're spending the public or the public funds are paying for a project, there's a lot more kind of justification early on in a project. I mean, I can choose to make anything I want, and if you know, give it to a gallery to try and sell it. If they don't sell it, I don't get any money for it. That's just the economics of what I do. I mean, I try and make things that are interesting to me, obviously all the time, but that might only be interesting to me or two or three people, you know. There is that kind of bizarre thing about being an artist. I suppose in a way, a project like this introduces a kind of, it makes me have a kind of different sort of responsibility towards the audience, which is interesting. In terms of time frames for things, very often as part of a brief, you might be asked to make sure that something can exist for 25, 30 or 40 years, because otherwise they can't get the funding to do it. So, and it might, the Wobston thing at the beginning, although it's plants, it will only last until, even though it's irrigated, it will only last until the frost. But we negotiated the situation so that they then retain the right to then replant that, for instance, at any other time. So it has a time scale that's slightly different.
The Folkestone Triennial calls things permanent, which may not be permanent.
Ah, because there's a policy of some works staying in Folkestone, is that right?
After each triennial, a number of works remain in the town to become a kind of museum without walls. But there's no guarantee, because none of these projects have ever been done before, that they will last. They're called permanent, but, you know, Mark Wallinger's Folkestones, which is a beautiful monument to the lives, the 19,000 lives that were lost on the first day of the Battle of the Somme, has to be repainted. It's a flat monument of 19,000 something stones, each hand numbered and each stone representing a life lost. And it's the people of the Folkestone have really taken to it. They put flowers on it, it's understood as a monument. But it has to be repainted by hand by some poor student sitting on a cushion every few months.
Oh, as often as that?
Yeah.
Wow. Because it's outside and because it's subject to...
Yeah, so you can never, I mean, I don't know about you, but you just cannot tell what's going to happen to a work. And most artists have never made whatever piece they're going to make.
That's part of the problem.
Part of the charm of asking certain artists is because they've never made such a work. And so the curator gets kudos for getting an artist to do something completely new. And even if you have done it before, you've never done it in that particular place with those particular weather conditions, which you can't underestimate. Niamh, my ex-colleague from Folkestone Triennial, told me a story when I first arrived of an artist installing something underwater and insisting not to do it himself, and it all being swept away the next tide and it all having to be reinstalled. It was an underwater work, and they just hadn't understood the force of the tide.
Yeah.
And you just can't, the weather conditions are quite ferocious on the coast. And then, you know, you haven't tested those materials, you don't know about vandalism. One piece got completely vandalised last time, had to be remade after the triennial opened. And that was, like your piece, supposed to be a sort of anti-vandalism piece. It was meant to make it a slightly dodgy area more welcoming to the public. Had the opposite effect, drew attention to the site, and, got vandalised.
I once was asked to propose something for Cardiff town centre. It didn't happen. It was to do with the money was going to come from some art consultants had organised and curated some art projects around Queen Street, around the kind of the centre of Cardiff, you know. And the money was going to come in various phases from, you know, hotels that were building an extra couple of floors, and if they got permission to do that, only if they were put some money into the kind of public art kitty or something. I mean, it's all kind of weirdly linked and stuff. But anyway, this thing didn't happen and my project didn't happen. But it still had to go through all the motions of the design and sort of structural engineer tests and then to planning or something. But there was a really brilliant bit because it was a cutout piece in the precinct, and it had to have a kind of anti climbing kind of thing built into it, and an anti-graffiti thing built into it. And you just can't do that. And I said, well, how do I, you know, what are you saying that I need to do? And they said, well, you know, you can't have a hole smaller than this big, because that counts as a toe hold. And we're sort of so I said, okay, so that was fine. We worked that in. But then it was three layers of something, and there was a gap in between the layers. And the street cleaning team actually are the ones that virtually got the thing thrown out of planning, because they said, oh no, you're going to get like cups and stuff wedged in between.
And they were
the
probably
things.
Right.
And they probably were right. And I said, well, okay, why don't we make the pieces the same width of the railings that you have in the town centre then? Because obviously you know that's an acceptable width. And they said, we don't like that either. And actually, if we could change it, we would. And the thing didn't actually happen anyway. But in terms of climbing, we worked out a way of, you know, I've done a project recently in Oxford, which I haven't shown.
They were probably your public, you know, who were going to see it so much.
Right. On the lamppost, the ladder bars are frequently snapped off because kids climb up it and break into it, even though as part of the plan for the site as a whole, there was a whole kind of landscaped area that was going to be built up with thorns and stuff all around it, so you couldn't get to the lamppost, which the council, for one reason or another, completely unilaterally decided to scrap that part of the project right at the end to save some money. And so now the lamppost is kind of exposed, and all the kids that go skateboarding around First Sight have a go at hanging off the ladder bars. So we made the ladder bars so they just snap off, because that way it doesn't damage the lamppost. And there's a whole set of these things that are in a storage cupboard at First Sight, and they have to put these things back up all the time.
Well, no one thinks of the kind of maintenance budget. That's the thing. And you know, all the budget goes on making the thing, and then who's going to look after it for 4, 10, 25 years?
Right.
It might need to be remade.
Yeah,
exactly. I mean, that's where those issues about longevity come in. Very often the person that writes the maintenance part of the contract is the fabricator rather than the artist, because they have a better understanding of how things are made. I mean, all of the things that I've shown you, I've involved a lot with the people that are doing them, but I'm actually not making them in my studio.
Does that cause a problem in terms of who's actually making the work? I know the fabricator and you, but sometimes then the curator gets involved with dealing with the fabricator, don't you find? And there's becomes this blurred boundary of whose work is actually making it.
I mean, I haven't had a bad experience like that, but I can see a scenario where there would be, you know, you're given somebody that's going to make something on a project. And actually, the shed project that I showed last, initially, when they couldn't work out, when the politics of the council procurement process was such that it was going to just be so long-winded, it was going to add another ridiculous amount of money to this whole process. And someone suggested at some meeting that, you know, maybe I could run it as an art project from my end, because then I would circumnavigate some of that kind of political scenario. It's difficult. I went with my fabricators, who in the end were thrown off. Not even by me. We were suddenly just told that we've got some other people that are going to make it now. And I'd spent, you know, like a year working with the guys that I work with often on lots of projects, and that sort of go to them and say, look, I'm really sorry, but you're out, and there's nothing to do with me. And it was really an awkward moment. I think in the end they were quite glad they didn't take it on, because it looked like it was going to be a bit of a nightmare job. But some other people came in, and they could have been an absolute disaster, and I was really worried about it. But actually I spoke to them, and went and met them, and actually they were fine, and they kind of got it, and they actually did it probably in a more simple way than we could have done it, because it's not the sort of thing that we normally do. And that's the other thing, in the same way that artists often don't do something, you know, they're doing something for the first time. Often you're asking people who are making the stuff for you to do something slightly out of their comfort zone as well, and they can only sort of second guess how it's going to go, and you can have complete nightmares. I mean, touch wood, I haven't, but you never know.
I wonder if it might be a good time to open to the floor for any questions that anyone might have that maybe have come up in the course of the discussion. Does anyone have any questions? Even comments? Yeah.
Do you think it's hard now to make an effective piece of public art, because you're sort of competing with things that look like public art, kind of
I mean, yeah, in a way. I mean, there's lots of stuff that goes on with kind of commercial spaces, I think, that is just, has always been there, really. I mean...
Well, architects often, their plans include a bit of public art.
Yeah.
If you're unlucky and they don't have anyone who knows about art, might just get commissioned by some random person and look like public art, but it's really just an architect's idea of public art.
So they look like something that's kind of made not to be looked at, in a sense, right? Yeah, a blob, maybe.
Yeah. Or a sort of random pavilion or a bit of public space.
I think that's where you have to make sure that you do something that... is related to your everyday other art practice, if you like. Because if you do that and it doesn't become a kind of standalone project that's in a way completely out of context or seemingly out of context with anything else that you do, there are two problems with it, really. One, that for the Camden glass wall, I was asked at the presentation if I would do something else, and it was to do with the budget and other something different. And I said, well, the thing is, in a way, there's no point you asking me to do something if I'm not going to do something that looks like a kind of Simon Periton, for want of a better phrase, because that's why you're asking me to do it. And there's a thing about being the artist. It's not an egotistical thing. It's just about the way that linked to the whole idea of how a bit of work is made and what a bit of work is who's made it. And if you go, you know, if you commission Gavin Turk to do something and a bit of work, but then you go past a shop that's got somebody that's done a bit of a Gavin Turk on it, it's not a Gavin Turk. So it's not the same. And so there's another thing about what the public funds are buying and what they're buying, because it becomes part of a collection of a public site. It might become a part of a, you know, the artwork becomes part of the shopping centre or the thing, and it's owned by somebody. Somebody does actually own it, even though it's a public realm work. Somebody's paid for it, and it's part of some council's collection or someone's something or other somewhere. And so you want, you know, to make sure that they're getting what they want from the money they're spending. You want to make sure they're getting something authentic and that's something to do with you. If you do that and you stay true enough to your kind of artistic ideals, whatever they might be, then I think you shouldn't have to worry about if somebody else makes something that looks a bit like yours or something, because that happens anyway. You know, you can't legislate against that.
I think there's a danger in trying to respond too much to a site, because you can never know everything about it, and again, context change. It can be very patronising to the locals if you've made something where you've done a little bit of research, the curator's handed you a sheet with a little bit of history of the area, and you're just sort of responding to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, if it's completely out of the realms of what you might do or be interested in anywhere else, that's definitely true.
I'm wondering about the way, obviously, the history of public art is actually going right the way back to the sculpture in the plinth, Trugsway, that you showed earlier on, is about, obviously it's about a history of the way public spaces are used, but also the way public spaces are looked at, right, and how much attention they are given. So that, for example, those kind of bronze the sculptures that you see in Trafalgar Square on the Mall are like part of a sort of ceremonial role within that particular open space. But our urban spaces now sort of maybe, I don't want to sound too kind of Daily Mail about this, but they are slightly sites of inattention rather than attention, right? If you go to a public space, you see people looking at phones or like not perhaps so much aware of the immediate urban environment. Do you think that there, I mean, maybe that's wrong, it's just something that, you know, I think is perhaps something that we're starting to see, that public spaces are sort of more and more non-spaces or spaces we're not so aware of. First of all, I don't know if that's true or not. I think there's maybe some truth in it, but is there a way in which public art can respond to the way that we now experience and use public space, which is less and less of somewhere that we are aware of, maybe? Do you think that's true? Am I going too far? Tell me if you're going to.
Can do. It has to be a really, really good piece of public art.
Right.
I don't think it makes up for the lack of public space. Nothing can.
Yeah.
It's not like we built a massive Trafalgar Square since then. There's not like a massive space.
Yeah.
In London. And but on the other hand, public space is cluttered up with a whole bunch of statues which no one looks at and could easily be melted down and used for something else. That's
yeah.
true. But maybe it reminds us of our history. Perhaps we have to think that the statues around Trafalgar Square were built at a time when public space was being created. Master planning was happening in London in a way that just doesn't happen anymore, which, for good or bad, did take into account space for people to operate.
Yeah.
I think it would be interesting to do a public artwork that was an app for everybody to look at on their phone because they're looking at their phones all the
right.
time. I mean, that would be the way I would look at that. It's like a kind of, you know, you open up how a work is made and what medium it's made in. I mean, I think
yeah.
to some extent we're talking about public artworks as objects and things, which in many respects is quite old-fashioned in some ways. It's more like an idea of maybe what a museum space might be about rather than an ideas space, I suppose. I mean, I did a show with a friend of mine, which I could have showed slides of actually, I realised I didn't do it, about a sort of fictitious public art proposals and things that were never going to be realised for one reason or another, and one of them was an idea of an app or something that would happen with an iPhone or something, because that seemed like the most common usable space, you know, publicly or something in a way. And I think that might be more interesting in sort of opening up those ideas.
Also,
no one's ever going to ask you to do it, unfortunately. Yeah. That's the thing. No, you know.
Well, that's it. You just don't have to wait to be commissioned. I mean, you know, I think there is a very interesting uncommissioned public art that's happening all the time. You know, London has had an amazing surge of interesting street art in the last 15, 20 years, which a lot of which is much more interesting than the commissioned stuff.
Sure. Yeah, exactly.
Well, I mean, the Banksy's uncommissioned, or theoretically it's uncommissioned, right? So.
Yeah.
Any more questions from anyone?
I suppose it would be interesting to know, like, on a practical level, if you or Jen even would have any kind of advice that you would give to curators that were creating public art. I mean, you've covered a few things already, like getting artists involved really early on and being open to their ideas and so on, but is there something that you kind of wish you could sort of say to curators at the beginning of a project that would help make a great project?
I mean, I think, well, I mean, I suppose in an ideal world, from an artist's point of view, loads more money to do something and much less restriction about what you can and can't do. But, or can we bypass building control or something? I mean, that would be great if there was some way of doing that. But I mean, that's just, it's sort of like stupid, but actually, that's probably the biggest headache in the whole thing.
I think the curator's job is to make friends with councils and planning departments and do all of that sort of schmoozing first, and have more money up your sleeve, because these projects always cost a lot more than, and the artists don't know. Well, they're often asked to come up with the budgets, which seems crazy to me, because one, they're often the fabricators end up changing anyway. Two, they have no idea about all these access issues, scaffolding. This is not their terrain. So actually having a kind of a separate budget for a lot of those things which don't perhaps intrude on the artist's budget might help. But I think budgets are often a source of contest, and planning departments, you know, coming in very late in the day and suddenly saying no. And that shadow of needing planning permission, whether it's from the council or from English Heritage, and it taking a long time, that's something. I mean, it's not always possible, but knowing that and starting the process as early as possible and trying not to stress the artist about that.
I can tell you a funny story about sheds, actually, which is quite, I mean, it's absurd in a way, but the fact that the project had kind of run over budget anyway, and it was all to do with the logistics of organising and not to do with the fabrication of the artwork, exactly like you say. All it took maybe best part of 2 years to organise and to negotiate when and how this was going to happen. And all the way along, right from the first proposal that I went to and, you know, showed a PowerPoint thing, it was going to be clad in timber, and the design was going to be clad in timber because that's the cheapest and quickest way of doing it, sort of thing. And at the 11th hour, just as the fabricators already made the staff, it was just about getting it put onto the building, taking off the building. Building control said, it's got to be fireproofed. I was going, what? Again, it's got to have fireproof coating. And again, why is it going to have fireproof coating? So, because it's wood on a structure in the public realm. We're saying, but it's outdoors. And then we're going, yeah, but, and it was something to do with its proximity to a public highway, which was the canal, and the railway was in within 50 meters of both of these things. So we had this bizarre thing where they said, how fireproof is your cladding? And I said, it's marine ply. I can't think of anything less fireproof than wood. So we had this stupid scenario. And you have to kind of, fire ratings are for fire exiting a building. So you have 30 minutes or an hour and a half. That gives something enough time to burn before it collapses so that you can vacate a building. This is an outdoor shed. They had to hand spray every panel with a fire rating coating. Just because we had to. And that then just added 80 grand to the budget at the end of a project that was already fabricating ways to go. So that's the sort of things you have to kind of.
So triple your contingency, yeah. Have in mind.
Triple your contingency.
Yeah, yeah. And also be careful, sometimes these things end up being considered buildings, which you didn't expect. Come up with this whole other set of things.
Yeah.
Problems. So yeah, it's very bureaucratic, you know.
I mean, linked to that from an artist's point of view as well, is this thing that very often you're talking to people, councils or something, who have a budget, a pot of money, and it's a sizable pot of money usually. And there's a slight look of panic around the room when you realise that they've just invited six slightly weird artists in to spend their money on this sort of project. And you can see that they don't want to give you the money. They just don't want to let you have the money to do the project because they don't quite trust you as an artist. And I've done a few of these sort of things now, and just being able to show that I've done one thing that actually happened and went on budget, they just relax. It's really funny. Mm-hmm. And that's, you probably don't see that in the same way as we do, but there's a sort of bizarre scenario where they want, they've asked an artist or somebody to do an art project, but they don't kind of want to let go of it as well enough to kind of let you do it. I suppose in a way that might be something, if artists could be allowed to kind of, it's an element of trust really which becomes part of that negotiation, which is quite crucial I think early on.
Yeah, I think giving artists enough trust so that they don't self-censor. I've seen artists kind of do something that's less elaborate than they would have liked to because they think that it won't be allowed. Or indeed gone the opposite way and thought, oh, this is my first commission, I should do something massive and really flamboyant, and actually that won't work and that would be really embarrassing for them.
Yeah.
I guess there's other ways
of saving them from themselves.
I'm asking a really impossible question, but it must come up, I'm sure. Because if you're dealing with commissions and you're dealing with councils, you must have to deal with evaluation to some extent and whether or not a project has been successful and how you determine that. Does that come up? Have you had to deal with that with folks? Then, like, how do you assess whether, you brought up this kind of danger word of engagement and things like that, but how do you...
Well, I guess luckily for the individual artist, it's considered as a whole, I think.
Right.
It's been counting how many people have seen it, which is a ridiculous idea because it's someone pressing the little button, plus anyone who might have seen it in the newspapers you can get away with. So, you just look at the number of circulation, number of the newspapers. It's crazy. Right. Because then there's another element. A lot of people won't actually see the art in the flesh. They will see it on the social media, newspapers, magazines, art magazines. So you have a really bizarre audience these days. It's not just the local audience. I mean, often these things have a sort of art-related audience, and a local audience, and then a tourist maybe audience as well, plus the internet audience. Got very different people seeing it. You know, you're tempted to say a successful project is one that everyone likes, but that's, you know, that's hard. That's hard to gauge. I mean,
yeah,
it's very rare for contemporary art to be placed in, you know, to be set to those kinds of standards, right? To be able to say this many people have seen it, you wouldn't find that happening.
It's only to do with funding. It's only to do with funding. Yeah. If it's anything to do with the Arts Council, then you have to be able to show those people have seen it, those businesses. That's how they justify giving you the money. So,
but now I live in a town which has got lots of public art. I feel like I'm on both sides, and you know, I'm interested in what's going to happen because it's going to be on my doorstep, and I'm going to have to walk past it every day. And I do take offence if it's a crap piece of public art.
Yeah.
On the other hand, you know, I've some really brilliant piece of public art I've stayed, and my favourite from the last triennial is a very kind of modest set of pieces by Sarah Staton by the harbour, which are just kind of little pavilions really, and they look like they've always been there. They've been left alone, no one's graffitied them because I think they've instantly fitted in, but yet they haven't done anything that looks kind of local or tried to be vernacular in any way. They're odd, weird, slightly alien looking pieces, but their scale and the material, the Corten steel she's used is brilliant for that scenario. It looks settled in, and yet it's fun. It's a kind of sculpture you can climb on, go inside, sit on, stand on. Dorsch likes looking through the peepholes. It's just a brilliant piece of public art. It doesn't matter if you know whether it's art or not. And you know, you can feel that the artist didn't mind either whether you saw it as art or just enjoyed it as unusual seating or unusual kind of pavilion.
Mm. Oh, fantastic. Well, I'm afraid that we have to conclude there. But thank you both so much for coming in. And I thought, I mean, we absolutely fascinating. In fact, our audience, similarly, it's not just this audience here, it's also those who will be watching this online, and so we'll be counting the beans as well for that, I suppose. But thank you both very, very much, and thank you all very much for coming along.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.